Our morning session, a topic, modeling of PMSM and its application in electrical vehicles. For this, we are having today's resource person, Dr. K.M. Ravi Ishwar sir, from SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Chennai. Let me introduce our today's resource person. He received the B.Tech degree from Jawaharlal Nehru Technology University, Anandpur. Completed his M.Tech degree from Vellore Institute of Technology, Vellore, and he received PhD degree from National Institute of Technology, Warangal. Currently, he is working with Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering at SRM Institute of Science and Technology, main campus, Chennai. He has authored several scientific papers in the field of electric motor drives and published various reputed journals such as IEEE journals, IET, Taylor Francis journals, etc. His research areas are electric motor drives, power electronics, and power converter circuits. So with this brief introduction, I welcome today's resource person, Dr. K.M. Ravi Ishwar sir. On behalf of all the participants, on behalf of Sanjay Ghodaut University and Electrical Department, I welcome you, sir. And I kindly request you to start the session.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for your kind introduction.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to congratulate Department of EEE, Sanjay Ghodaut University and organizing committee for successful going on this FDP program. So let me start my presentation. So in this presentation, I will show you the MATLAB simulation of the PMSM drive. So what are the things you need to do in MATLAB? So before that, just I want to give small introduction, and also I would like to concentrate on the modeling of PMSM. So why the PMSM modeling is important? See, if you want to analyze any machine, so first you need to know the dynamic performance of the machine. So with the help of dynamic equation. So I would like to introduce the PMSM modeling. So, and its application in electric vehicle. So, I'll be taking one vector control scheme, and I will be simulating the PMSM drive, and I'll show the performance of the PMSM drive with the MATLAB simulation. So, let me start the presentation. So, these are the contents of my presentation. So, just outlook on power electronics. So, application of power electronics, electric drives. So what is electric drive and its block diagram, so motivation of the electric drive, classification of electric drive, application of AC drive. So I'll be showing you the simulation results for the classical and the modern control schemes for the PMSM drive. So only at the end the simulation studies and the conclusion. So let me start telling the definition of power electronics. I feel that it will be empty. So what is power electronics? So it is the application of power semiconductor devices to control and conversion of electric power efficiently. So nowadays, you know, power electronics are having much more application in any area. So if you see the the classification, so the main subjects present in the power electronics, the main research also, if I can say, so first topic is power semiconductor devices. So where you can study the various power semiconductor devices, and at the end the second topic is power converter. So generally these power semiconductor devices are said to be the heart of power converter. So all of you know that there are four classification of power converters, that is AC to DC, which we call it as a rectifier, and DC to DC converter, DC to AC inverter, and AC to AC, it is a cycloconverter. So I can say these power semiconductor devices are going to build this power converter. So by using the power semiconductor devices. So nowadays there are so much research in power semiconductor devices also. Till now we are using IGBT switches, MOSFET IGBT. So there are so many researchers where the efficiency of power semiconductor devices has to improve. and also the switching frequency. Nowadays they are going in terms of hundreds of kilohertz, because as the efficiency and performance of switching devices is going to improve, so we can go for the higher switching frequencies and getting the better control response. So let me tell you the block diagram of electric drive. So this is general block diagram, diagram of electric drive. So you can see here, source, power modulator, motor, load. So there will be a sensing unit. So the sensing unit is going to convey the information about the sensor signals to the control unit. The input command is given to the control unit. So the control unit, based on the input command and the sensing unit command, so it is going to generate the control response to the power modulator. So power modulator is going to act according to that. So, and it is going to give the variable supply to the motor. Suppose if the motor is AC motor, if the supply is the DC, then definitely you need to use a DC to AC converter. Suppose if it is AC, you can use a two-stage conversion, or directly you can go with the cyclo converter. So generally, what is this electric drive? It is a form of machine equipment designed to convert electric energy into mechanical energy. So this point is important, and provide electric control on this process. So this point is very important. So so by providing electric control on this process, so we are going to achieve the speed control over the machine. So this is the basic definition of electric drive. So nowadays the electric drives are powering the future of industry. So these electric drives are said to be much more efficient. So I want to give one example why the electric drives are efficient. So by taking an application of pump. So you can see the example with the constant speed and variable speed. So this is possible with the electric drives. So this is the pump characteristics. So you can see the first line here. So this line represents the pump characteristics. So and this line represents the pipe characteristics. So at equilibrium, you are achieving the flow rate of 100%. So I want to reduce my flow rate to 60%. So with the constant speed application, I can put throttle valve in pipe and I can control the flow rate. So this is the new characteristics with the help of throttle valve placed in the pipe. So this is the new equilibrium point, and you can achieve the 60% flow rate. So you are achieving the flow rate in case of constant speed application. Whereas in variable speed drive, instead of putting the throttle valve, you try to adjust the speed of your motor. So when you try to adjust the speed of motor, your pump characteristics are going to shift here. So this is the new equilibrium point. So where you are getting the flow rate of 60%. So if I compare both these two, so what is power? Power equal to pressure into flow rate. So if I compare both of these constant speed and the variable speed, you can see here there is a power saving in case of variable speed drive. So that is the reason nowadays electric drives are much more efficient compared to the constant speed drives. In case of electric vehicle also, you all know that there is a much losses associated with the IC engine. So nowadays there is a much motivation to move from the IC engine operated vehicle to the motor operate electric vehicle. Okay, so that is the main motivation nowadays, electric drives. So let me tell you the classification of electric drives, DC drives and AC drives. So you know, DC drives, if I want to tell in drives point of view, DC drives is going to give much more better dynamic response compared to the AC drive. From dynamic point of view, DC drives are said to be having good dynamic performance compared to the AC drive. But all of you know the limitations of the DC drive. It requires periodic care. The reason I can say that it is having commutator, not applicable for high speed and voltage range. Its application is not suitable in explosive and corrosive location. So these points and all, I guess it is very familiar to you. So though DC drives are providing much more better dynamic response, it is having these limitations. So due to these limitations, we are now replacing the DC drive with the AC drive. If you see the torque equation, in case of DC drive, the torque equation is very simple. Torque equal to K into phi into IA. So where IA is the armature current, phi is the field current. Okay. So by making the field flux constant, in case of drive application, controlling the drive with the flux is not ever recommended, because to control drive by varying the flux, it takes more time constant. It is going to give the sluggish response, I can say. So because of that reason, we are going to make the flux constant always, so we can achieve the torque control of machine by controlling the armature current through a converter. That may be any converter, okay, based on the supply. Suppose if you are having AC, so you need to keep AC to DC converter. If you are having DC, you can keep DC to DC converter. So simply by controlling the armature current, you can control the torque of the machine. So due to this benefit, it is going to give higher dynamic performance. I will tell you why AC drives are providing a poor dynamic performance. So I'll tell that now. If you see the circuit of this DC drive, so there are two excitations. So one is a field excitation, the other is armature excitation. As I told, you should not vary the flux to provide this speed control, because it provides sluggish response. So that is the reason the field excitation is kept constant. So when you keep field excitation is constant, the field component of current is going to be constant and the field flux is said to be constant. And coming to the torque component, so this torque component represents the armature current. So by varying the armature current with the help of converter, you can able to have the high dynamic performance for the DC drive. Now coming to the AC drive, that may be induction motor or permanent magnet synchronous motor, any machine, there is a problem. It is going to give poor dynamic response. If I compare both the DC and AC drives, the problem is the AC drives are associated with the poor dynamic response. What is the reason? In AC drive, so what may be, that may be the induction motor or permanent magnet synchronous motor, there is a single port. There is only one port through which you are providing both active component of current and the magnetizing component of current. If you see the DC drive, there are two ports. From one port, you are providing the, I can say, field component of current, and the other port is going to provide armature component of current. So always the field component of current is said to be constant, and by varying the armature component of current, you can meet the dynamics. Whereas in case of AC drive, suppose if there is any sudden changes from the load side, from the shaft side, or if there is any sudden changes from the supply side, okay, so it is going to affect both armature component of current and the field component of current. What I mean to say is that it may be the active component of current and it may be the magnetizing component of current. So both the currents are going to affect, because there is a single port through which you are going to give both the armature and the field component of current. So both are interlinked each other, coupled each other. So that is the reason it is going to give poor dynamic response. It is going to give the poor dynamic response. So it draws active and reactive power from a single port. So this is the first point you need to remember, why the AC drives are going to provide poor dynamic response compared to the DC drive. However, nowadays AC drives are becoming popular due to this advantage. We are having now sophisticated digital processors. So these processors are helping to execute control algorithms which can make the response of the AC drive much more faster and competing with the DC drive. So due to the advantages of these sophisticated digital processors, nowadays there is a much motivation for the AC drive. So these are the some of the applications of the AC drive. The source is from ABB, you know ABB, right? So these are the mining and minerals, chemical, oil, gas, marine system, metal, cement, power, and so on. So you can find anywhere AC drives nowadays, and they are successfully replacing the DC drive. So in AC drive, I can say it is very better to select the TMSM, which is a type of special machine. And you know, you may ask, why can't BLDC, why can't SRM? So you know, there is a tough competition between all these special machines. In case of PMSM, if you see the features and the advantages of the PMSM, it is having improved power factor, compact size, high efficiency, high power density. So actually, in our lab, both the machines are having same rating, 5 HP and 5 HP for induction motor and for PMSM. PMSM size, if I see, it will be very less. And also weight also, it will be very less compared to the induction motor. So, and also, it is having high efficiency, compact size, improved power factor. So, these are the some of the notable features of the PMSM. And the applications of PMSM, electric vehicle. So, you can see there is a so much research, the application of PMSM in electric vehicles. You can able to see so many research papers. So in this lecture, I'm going to give the control schemes for the PMSM to attain the speed control. So you know the conventional control scheme, that is a scalar control scheme. I can name it as a V by F control scheme also. So where we proportionally change voltage and the frequency to get the flux in a machine constant. So you can ask, here also we are maintaining flux constant, and you are telling the scalar control, you know that the scalar control provides poor dynamic response compared to the vector control scheme. Here flux also we are maintaining constant as like in DC machine. So what will be the problem? The problem is that it is failed to address the phasor control of excitation. So we are controlling only magnitude. We are not seeing the instantaneous value. Okay, we are controlling only magnitude wise, and instantaneous action we are not doing in case of scalar control. So that is the main disadvantage with the scalar control scheme. So coming to the vector control scheme, as I told, the main problem associated with the scalar control is it fails to address the phasor control of excitation. It is going to do only magnitude control, I can say. So the phasor control of excitation is going to be failed in case of a vector control, scalar control scheme. So now vector control schemes are arrived. So where you can do the phase control of excitation. So with that, you can able to achieve the good dynamic response. So you can have instantaneous electromagnetic torque control. Instantaneous electromagnetic torque control is possible with the help of vector control schemes. So with the advent of digital era microprocessors, vector control techniques can be introduced to emulate the DC characteristics. So, as I said, vector control schemes are going to provide instantaneous electromagnetic torque control. So, if I say instantaneous electromagnetic torque control, your machine has to be modeled dynamically. So, because it has to see the instantaneous response, based on that it has to give the control action. So, definitely, you need to model your machine with the dynamic conditions. So, that is the main importance of the dynamic modeling of PMSM. To analyze these control techniques and know the dynamic performance of machine, dynamic modeling of PMSM is required. So, we are going to see the dynamic modeling of PMSM now. So what are the dynamic equations of the PMSM we are going to see now. So these are the dynamic equations of PMSM. I guess all of you know that why we are going to three phase system ABC to two phase DQ system or alpha beta system to reduce the complexity of the system. So that you can easily analyze the system. So that is the main reason to go from ABC to PQ. So let us see how these equations are arrived. Because the title itself, there is a modeling of PMSM. So I need to explain these equations, how the equations are arrived. So this modeling can be done in either in stationary reference frame or rotating reference frame. Stationary or rotating reference frame. However, you can see here, in case of Panwan magnet synchronous motor, the magnet is going to present in the rotor side. So this magnet is going to affect the stator voltage and current, instantaneous induced EMF on torque of the machine. So it is better to model the PMSM in rotor side. So that is a rotor reference frame. Because the rotor component, that is Panwan magnet, is going to affect all these components. So if you can analyze the PMSM from rotor side, so it will be much more better and easier. So that is the reason the PMSM is going to model in the rotating reference frame, that is from the rotor side. Okay, rotor is always rotated synchronous speed because it is a permanent magnet synchronous motor. It is a type of synchronous motor, right? So I can say that the modeling is provided in synchronous rotating reference frame. So let us see how the equations are arrived. So let me first tell you the flux linkages equation. So lambda ds, so you know the flux linkage that is equal to L into I. So can have the two axis LL. Okay, so the first one is B axis. So you will be having two windings, fictitious windings in the D axis and the Q axis. So you are going to have the two windings. Okay, so D axis, on D axis and the Q axis. So what is lambda ds? So you know the flux linkage, the basic equation of the flux linkage, L into I. So with respect to D axis, it is a LD into IDS. So IDS is the current flowing in the winding of D axis. Okay, so and this lambda AF represents the flux of the permanent magnet. So I can frame lambda DS equal to LD IDS plus lambda AF. Coming to lambda QS, so lambda QS simply, it is a LQ into IQS. So this is the flux linkage equation. So now coming to the voltage equation. So VDS, so we are going to provide supply for this D axis winding as a VDS. So VDS equal to RS IDS. So this is like KVL equation only, analysis with the KVL equation only. So the supply equal to drops. So VDS equal to RS IDS. So this is the stator resistance drop. And this is the inductance drop. So where P is d by dt, where P equal to d by dt. So stator inductance drop d lambda qs by dt, d lambda ds by dt, minus here there is a one, we need to analyze whether it is plus or minus. I'll tell you how to get this one. Omega r lambda qs represents rotating EMF. Because we are doing the modeling in the rotating frame, right? So the machine is now rotating. The machine is now rotating. So it will interlink with the Q axis flux. Sometimes it is going to interlink with the Q axis flux. So there will be induced EMF due to the Q axis flux. So that I can write it as a omega r lambda Q axis rotating EMF. And I need to have this one, plus or minus. I need to, in coming, I'll tell you what will be the polarity. The rotating EMF polarity should be plus or minus. I'll explain you this one. Now coming to the Q axis equation, voltage equation. So VQS equal to RS IQS. So this is stator resistance drop, P lambda QS. So inductance drop, and also this is also a rotating EMF. It is a rotating EMF. So as I told, while explaining VDS. So in the same manner, in case of EQS also, the Q axis winding can interlink with the D axis flux. There will be linkages of the lambda ds to the Q axis winding. So this contributes a rotating EMF. So why it is getting means, as we are framing the equations in the rotating reference frame. So plus or minus omega r lambda ds. So I need to prove which polarity it has to be, either plus or a minus, to this rotating EMF. So I let you explain. So what polarity you need to keep for this VDS and VQS. So I am taking two fictitious models. First I'll explain you for VDS, and later I'll explain you for VQS. So as I told, there will be a interlinking of lambda QS to the D-axis winding. So Q-axis flux is like this. So assume fictitious machine having a windings here. So I need to find the effect of Q-axis flux on the D-axis winding, voltage effect. So this is the Q-axis flux, and coming to the fictitious machine, I will assume that there are some windings here, as like an DC machine. So I want to find the rotating induced EMF due to the Q-axis flux. So assume that my rotor is moving in this direction with the speed of omega r. So I want to find the induced EMF in this conductor. So these are the conductors placed there. This is a fictitious, I can say a fictitious machine. So this is the D axis. This is the D axis. So you can apply Fleming's right hand rule. So keeping the thumb in the direction of omega r, and the middle finger, the second finger in this direction, it represents flux direction. So you can able to find the induced EMF in the conductor. You can able to find the induced EMF in the conductor. I can have here a cross, just you can check with your hand. Yeah, here it will be dot. Sorry. Here it will be dot. Here it will be dot. The middle finger is going to be towards you. So it will be dot. So obviously the other side will be cross. So now we'll find the flux direction. So with this induced EMF, we'll find the flux direction. So if I want to find the net flux direction, you apply right hand thumb rule, you can have the flux direction in this way. In this way. So if I draw the net flux direction, it will be like this here also. So whatever the induced EMF due to the Q-axis flux, whatever the induced EMF generated due to the Q-axis flux, it is helping the D-axis voltage, VD. So you can say that both are in the same direction. Both the induced EMFs are said to be in the same direction. So I can write that VD plus omega R lambda QS. Because both are aiding in nature. So this is given as RS IDS plus P lambda ds. P lambda ds. So if I want to shift this term to the right hand side, so what will be the polarity? Vd equal to RS IDS plus P lambda ds minus omega r lambda q. So that is the reason here there should be a negative polarity here. So you can see here minus omega r lambda q. Because this rotating EMF, rotational induced EMF, is going to help the d-axis voltage VDS. Both are said to be in phase. So if you do the similar analysis for the q-axis voltage, you can able to find that both are said to be in opposing in nature. VQ minus omega r lambda ds is going to come. If you apply the same fictitious machine and take the d-axis flux, take the d-axis flux and the q-axis windings are here. So this is the voltage where you are going to see, and your rotor is rotating in this direction. So you please apply your Fleming's right hand rule. So you can find here cross, flux is in this direction, d-axis flux is in this direction, and rotation is in this direction. You please apply your Fleming's right hand rule. So you are going to get this cross here and dot here. So if you apply your Fleming's right hand rule, you are going to get the flux, net flux due to this induced EMF is in this direction. However, the VQ polarity is in this direction. So you can say here the VQ, the rotor induced EMF is going to oppose the VQ. The rotational induced EMF, I can say that the rotational induced EMF, that is omega r lambda q, it is opposing the VQ. So that is the reason here it should be VQ minus omega r lambda ds. So when it comes to the right hand side, it is going to come as VQS equal to RS IQS plus P lambda QS plus omega r lambda ds. So these are the important required equations for the analysis of PMSM dynamically. So this is the voltage equation, flux equation. Remember, these are instantaneous. It is going to give the instantaneous it is an instantaneous quantity, small v. Okay, it is an instantaneous quantity, small I. So from this, you want to find the torque equation. So if you can able to separate omega r terms, and if you multiply current here, instantaneous current, so you will get the torque equation. So you can verify, separate the omega r terms and multiply with the current, so that is IQS and IDS, you are going to get the this equation. So torque equation is represented as 3 by 2 P by 2 lambda ds IQS minus lambda QS IDS. So with this equation, the equivalent circuit is drawn here for VQS and VDS. So this is the Q-axis circuit and this is the D-axis circuit. So these are the dynamic modeling of the PMS. So after modeling of the machine, so you need to apply the control technique. So if I want to say the control techniques, vector control techniques, the key vector control techniques nowadays are field oriented control, a direct torque control and predictive control. So there is a lot of research going on these control areas. So this is a basic control structure for the field oriented control operated PMSM drive. So as I told, it has to be done in rotating reference frame. The control, the FOC control is going to do in rotating reference frame. So let me tell you from this point onwards. So this is the speed command what you are going to give, and this is the actual speed. So you need to give to error detector. So after error detector, the error is going to give it to the speed PI controller. So it is going to generate the IQ star. See here. Here there should be a decoupled control for the torque and flux. There must be a concept of decoupled control for the torque and flux as like in DC machine. As in DC machine, we discussed that there are what I can say, structural wise, there are two ports. For one port, we are making the excitation constant. For another port, we are varying the excitation to meet our demand. However, I can't modify the physical nature of the machine, physical structure of the machine. So here also, with this control schemes also, the PMSM remains as it is. Structure, it won't be modified. But what I am going to do here means, I am showing my controller, PMSM, that my controller is going to see this PMSM is an equivalent DC machine. My controller is going to see this PMSM is an equivalent DC machine. So that is called decoupled control of flux and torque. So here you can see here IQ star. So it is going to represent torque component of current. And please remember, as you are doing the this controlling everything in a rotating reference frame, the IQ and the ID are said to be magnitudes, means they are having values, not alternating. So these are said to be stationary. IQ and ID are said to be stationary. It is not alternating. So in case of DC machine also, armature current, it is a DC value. It is a DC, just a DC, fixed value. It is not alternating. So we are doing the controlling in rotating reference frame. The components IQ and ID are said to be fixed, but not alternating. So this IQ star represents torque component of current because it is going to fix the speed error. So the IQ star is generated in such a way to reduce the speed error. So until speed error is going to reduce near to zero, so till that IQ star is going to vary. So and this IQ star is given to the actual IQ. So this error is going to give it to the current controller. So the current controller is going to provide a VQ star. In the same manner, so this is the torque control loop. I can say this is a torque control loop. And there is a one more loop, that is flux control loop. So generally, you can see that in rotor itself, there is a permanent magnet. So there is no need of flux component of current. That is the reason PMSM is said to be, it is going to operate near to the unity power factor. The power factor of PMSM is almost unity. So because flux component of current not required. Flux already present with the permanent magnet, so it is going to provide. So no need to provide any flux component of current. So here the ID star command is said to be 0, and it is compared with the actual ID. So the error is given to the current controller to set the VD star. So once you get a VD star, VQ star, you are going to have the two-phase to three-phase conversion. So ultimately, the machine we are not changing, as I said. So you require three references, VA star, VB star, VC star. So this can be done by the two-phase to three-phase conversion. So for this, you require angle row, which is the angle between lambda R and the D axis, stationary axis. I can say it is a stationary axis. Okay. So so this is the angle. This angle you require, so this can be obtained by integrating omega. So you will get the angle rho. So in the conversion of two phase to three phase system, you require angle rho. So you need to provide that angle. So once conversion is done, you are going to have the three references, VA star, VB star, VC star. So that is going to give it to the PWM inverter. So as I said, you require actual values of ID and IQ. So you need to sense IA, IB. So no need to sense all the three currents. So if you sense IA, IB, then IC equal to minus of IA plus IB because it is a balanced load. So no need to sense for three currents because economically it is not good. So you can sense two currents and you can get the IC. So you can do the conversion AC to DQ. So these are the actual current values, ID, IA. So these are required for the comparison here near to the error detector. So this is the basic control for the FOC operated EMS and drive. So let's see direct charge control. See, if I want to compare FOC and DTC, in FOC there is a PWM switch. So generally, the introduction of PWM switch, it is going to affect the dynamic performance. And also one more point, here the top control is going to be done by controlling the IQ. Means IQ. Controlling the current component of IQ, controlling IQ current, we are controlling the torque. So I can say that it is an indirect control process. Through currents, we are controlling the torque of the machine. So this is the main feature of the FOC. Through current, we are controlling the torque and the existence of PWM state. So if you compare the dynamic case, with the direct control, so it's going to provide good dynamic performance. Actually, the control case, they will provide good dynamic performance. When we compare between this DTC and FOC, so DTC is somewhat better. It is going to give better dynamic performance from the FOC. So let's see. This DTC, which is going to operate, what is the principle behind this DTC operation? So I can, and also, DTC is still more flexible than FOC. In the control of FOC, there are three state controllers. So one is state controller, current controller for getting the DTC stuff, and current controller for getting the DTC stuff. So, adjustment of KPK values, it is a somewhat tedious process. So, it is a complex control process in the FOC. So, coming to the DTC, it is more flexible compared to the FOC. So, what is behind the DTC? In DTC, we are not doing the DQ conversion, means DTC to DQ, we are not doing the conversion. So, we are doing the control scheme in stationary reference frame itself, but not in rotating reference frame. In case of FOC, we have done the control process in rotating reference frame in case of FOC. Whereas in case of DTC, we are doing control process in the stationary reference frame. So the components, the lambda, I can say the lambda DS, lambda QS, and VDS, VQS, these are said to be alternating. As I said, the controlling is said to be done in a stationary reference frame. So all these components are said to be alternating. So you may ask, sir, in case of DC machine, you want to provide, you want to compete with the dynamic performance of DC machine. So, and you are telling the quantities are alternating. So how you can match with the DC machine? So, what is the principle behind the torque control? So, instead of looking PMSM as a DC machine, what I am going to do means, I am going to control the instantaneous angle between the rotor flux and the stator flux by applying proper voltage vector. So, you can see this phasor diagram. So, this is the previous position of the rotor flux and this is the previous position of the stator flux. Now if I want to control the torque of the machine, so assume that I want to increase my torque of the PMSM. I want to increase my torque. So what I can do means, I can directly apply voltage vector without any PWM stage. I can directly apply voltage vector and I can bring change in flux. You can see here the relation. By applying voltage vector directly, proper voltage vector. you can able to bring change in flux, and you can able to create a change in angle between the stator flux and the rotor flux. When you can able to create the change in angle, instantaneous change in angle between the stator flux and rotor flux, you can have the direct control over the torque of PMS. You can able to have the direct control over the torque of the PMS. So that is the main advantage here. It is a direct torque control process. Unlike in FOC, through current components, we are doing the control over the torque. Whereas in case of DTC, we are seeing the angle between the ZS and ZR. So by controlling the angle between ZS and ZR with the application of proper voltage vector, we can able to provide the direct torque control of the PMSM. So this is the main principle behind the DTC operation. So if I provide the structure of the DTC, see, generally for both PMSM and induction motor, the structure won't vary. The structure of DTC won't vary. It will remain same. It is going to be same only. So there is no differences between the induction motor DTC and the PMSM DTC. Both are going to be same. So only the motor is going to change. Here it will be a PMSM. So you can see here, also there is a two loops. One is a torque control loop, the other is flux control loop. So unlike in FOC, here there is only one PA controller. There is only one PA controller in case of DTC. So there is no other than more than one PA controller. Only one PA controller is present in the speed control loop. So the error between the reference and the actual speed is going to give to the PA controller. So this PA controller is going to generate the reference torque required for the operation of PMSM. So the reference torque is going to set to meet the error condition near to zero. So omega R star should match with the omega R, approximately equal to omega R. So it is going to give the reference torque in such a way that omega R star should be equal to omega R. So once you get a reference torque value, so you need to compare with the actual torque. So that error is going to give it to the hysteresis controller, a three level hysteresis controller. Now coming to the flux loop, there is a reference flux and the actual flux, where you know that lambda S star equal to LSIS plus lambda F. As I said that you don't require the current, the flux component of current, IDS. IDS is set to be the flux component of current. So generally it is going to set 0. So by setting this value as 0, so you are going to get the lambda star value. So if you calculate lambda star value for your machine, so that reference value you need to give here. So for my machine, it came as a 0.7, 0.71 like that. So this is going to compare with the actual flux. Remember, these are vectors. Xi star is a magnitude, and this is also magnitude comparison here. So after comparing, the error is going to provide to the two level flux hysteresis controller. So at the end, you are going to have HSI, HTE, which are outputs of the torque hysteresis controller and the flux hysteresis controller. And as I told, the principle of DTC is based on the proper application of voltage vector. So you need to select the voltage vector properly to have the torque control and the flux control. So how to select the voltage vector? So that is the question. So for that, you are having the voltage vector table. So from this voltage vector table, you need to select the suitable voltage vector at all instants. So how this lookup table is designed? So let me give one example. Let me give one example. So assume that your startup flux is in sector one. So generally you need to divide whatever the voltage space vector diagram. Suppose if you are using two level inverter, you are going to have 7 voltage vectors V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6 and the null voltage vector. So you have to divide this voltage space vector into the 6 sectors. So you need to identify in which sector your flux space vector is going to present. So you need to give the information of Zs, the vector position information you need to give to this lookup table. So at the end I can say that you need to have the information of HT, HY and flux sector information. So all the three informations you need to have to select the voltage vector. So how the voltage vector is selecting? So assume that you require condition to increase torque and to increase the flux. You need to increase torque of the machine and you need to increase the flux of the machine. So this is the initial position of Zr. Initial position of Zr. So Zr is going to locate somewhere here. Okay. Now if you want to bring increase in torque value, so definitely you need to increase the angle between the Zs and Zr. So how to increase the angle between Zs and Zr? So to increase the angle between Zs and Zr, you can switch V3, you can switch the voltage vector V3. See, when you switch voltage vector V3, so it is going to follow the V3 direction. You can able to switch V2, both are going to increase the angle between Zs and Zr. And one more condition I require, I need to increase the flux. So if I want to increase the flux, I need to increase the length of this voltage vector, flux space vector. I want to increase the length of the flux space vector. So what is among in between V2 and V3? So which is suitable to satisfy both torque and flux control? So the based on this, you need to select which voltage vector you want to operate. So with this example, I need to select V2, because by selecting V2, I am getting a change in angle. I am increasing my angle between Zs and Zr, and at the same time, I am increasing the length of Zs. So I can increase the torque and flux. You may ask, is Zr is going to remain in same position? It won't change. You may get doubt. I can say that Zs is going having a better, faster dynamic response compared to Zr. Because you are providing the control from the startup side. Your supply is from startup side. So Zs is going to change instantly compared to the rotor permanent magnet. So Zs is going to change instantly. So by taking this advantage, we are going to have the improvement in the torque and at the same time improvement in the flux. So you need to select the voltage vector V2 for this condition. So in the same manner, you need to analyze for all the sectors. So I give an example with this. So command torque error command from the hysteresis controller is +1 and HSI is +1. So with this I selected V2. So in the same manner, you can analyze for the sector 2, sector 3, sector 4, sector 5, sector 6. So based on that, you need to predefine the voltage vectors in the lookup table for different conditions. When HT is -1, and when HSI is -1, HT is +1. So you need to look into the conditions and you need to predefine the voltage vector. So once predefining the lookup table, you need to write a program. So after writing program, so you need to give the information of HT, HSI and the sector information. So automatically your program is going to select the appropriate voltage vector based on these conditions HT, HSI and S of K. So after selecting the voltage vector, the switching combinations of voltage vector are going to directly apply to the inverter. Here there is no modulation stage. So there is a direct application of voltage vector based on the control of torque and the flux. So that is the reason DTC is said to be having a comparatively high dynamic performance when I compare with the FOC. So these are the some of the remarks of DTC. So there is no need to require any vector transformation. No PWM stage is present. We need to use the stasis controller. Switching frequency is not constant. One important observation. So there is a research to make the switching frequency constant in case of DTC operated PMSM drive. So because there is no modulation stage, right? So you can't make the switching frequency constant. So switchings are going to happen to meet the torque and flux control. And yeah, that's it. So this is the theory part I want to discuss with you. So now let me go to the simulation part, and I'll show you what are the things I built. Are you able to see my screen? Participant?
Sir.
Okay. So this is the simulation part. I'll come step by step from the reference speed command. From the reference speed command, I will come step by step. So this is the reference speed I given here. Just I will open this block. I'll explain you step by step. So this is the reference speed value, which is in a electrical quantities, omega r electrical, but not in mechanical. So mechanical means I need to do by 2 because it is a four pole machine. So you need to divide with a by 2 to get the mechanical. So the speed is represented in electrical. So this is the reference flux. As I told, the flux with my machine, I got 0.7. So these are the references I need to give. So this 0.7 should maintain constant. It should not change. It should maintain constant. As I told, you need to maintain flux constant. You should not control the machine by changing the flux, because you will obtain with a poor dynamic response. So let me show you the stasis controller part. I'll show you the block diagram and I'll explain. So that will be so this one omega r star omega r. So it is given to the error detector. So this one. So this is the omega reference, and this is the actual omega r from the machine. So assume that you got the actual omega r, actual speed of the PMSM. So this is the reference speed. I'll explain you step by step. Okay, now at this point of time, you assume that you have actual speed of the PMSM. So the error is given to the PI controller. So the PI controller is going to output the reference torque to meet the error near to zero. It is going to set the actual speed near to the reference speed. So the reference torque is generated in such a way to meet the actual speed of the PMSM near to the reference speed. So this reference torque is going to compare with the actual torque of the PMSM. So this is the actual torque of the PMSM. Assume that you got actual torque. Okay, we'll come step by step. Okay, so the error. So this error is going to given to the three level stasis controller. So you can see here +1, 0. So whenever the error crosses upper boundary, that is 1, So the output is 1. Whenever the HTTPS controller crosses is 0, so the output is 0. Error of the star crosses the 0, the output will be 0. So in the same manner, 0 minus 1. So whenever the error crosses the minus 1, so the output will be minus 1. So this is a 3-level HTTPS controller. So the output at the end, the output will be plus 1, 0, minus 1. And coming to the flux control loop, so this is the reference flux and this is the actual flux. You got the actual flux and you are comparing with the reference flux, that is 0.7, magnitude 0.7. So this is given to the one more hysteresis controller. So whenever the flux error crosses the limit 0.005, the output will be 1. Whenever the flux error crosses minus 0.005, the output will be minus 1. See, there may be a question. So how I set these values? So generally, 10% of rated torque is allowed to be the band of the hysteresis controller. 10% of rated torque. It will be there in the IEEE papers. So 10% of rated torque is said to be the band of the hysteresis controller for the torque. And generally for the flux, we usually select 0.005, like that. See, the switching frequency is going to depend upon this hysteresis controller. Because if you shrink this band, so there will be more number of switchings. So based on the switching frequency, you need to select switching frequency of your drive. You need to select this band. Otherwise, you may go with the higher switching frequency. So after completing this one, after completing this part, so we got the values of HSI and we got the values of HT. So now I want to know the flux sector information. So where is the flux sector information? This one. So if I open this, I'll open this one. Yeah. See, this, I'll go to this one. Yeah. See, you got the flux information, lambda, beta, lambda, alpha. So I converted it into rectangular to polar, I mean magnitude and the angle. So based on this angle, it is in radians, so I converted it into degrees, 180/5. So this angle is provided to this block. So with this angle, whatever the angle I am sensing, based on the angle, I have written program to find the sector. Whether the flux sector is in sector 1, sector 2, sector 3, sector 4, sector 5, sector 6. So based on this condition, it is going to select in which sector the flux vector is located. So that information you can get from this program. So after getting the information of HSI, HTE, S of K, so we have all the three information. So you need to write a program to select the appropriate voltage vector. So I have written program. Suppose if my flux sector, flux space vector is in sector 1, my flux space vector is in sector 1, and my flux error is plus 1 and torque error is plus 1, I need to select the voltage vector as a V2. So the same tabular column I represented here. So the same tabular column I represented in program. So if it is in sector 1, what voltage vectors need to be selected based on the information of HT and HSI. So this is HT and this is HSI. In the same manner, if it is in sector 2, what I need to select voltage vector. So for all the 6 sectors, I need to write the program. So after writing the program, so the voltage vector is going to come as the output. So if this voltage vector is going to be directly applied to the inverter. So yeah, the switching combination. So if it is V1, I need my switching combination is 100. If it is V2, my switching combination is 110. If it is V3, my switching combination is 010. So these are the switching combinations correspond to the voltage vector. So after getting the switching combination, so this is the inverter mathematical modeling. So instead of directly placing the inverter, so you can do the modeling of the inverter. So I can get the values of VAN, VBN, VCN. These are the phase voltages. So from the switching combinations, SA, SB, SC, and the applied DC voltage, okay, directly I can get the values of VAN, VBN, VCN. These are the phase voltages. So this phase voltages directly you give it to the machine. So here it is machine. So this is the PMSM model. So if I open this one, so VA, VB, VC, so this has to be converted into a DQ reference frame. So for that we have done the conversion, a DQ conversion. So DQ conversion means this one. So these are the equations to convert ABC to DQ. So this conversion we used to convert ABC to DQ. So we require angle, right? Rho, as I explained in theory. So omega integration, I'll get the angle rho. So after getting the VD and VQ from ABC, so directly you can give it to your model. Directly you can give it to your model. So whatever the equations I presented, let me go through the equations. Yeah, this one. So VDS equal to RSIDS plus P lambda DS minus omega R lambda QS. So the same thing here I represented. So VDS, see, from this equation I require lambda DS. VDS minus RSIDS, so this entire quantity I am moving it into left hand side, and this also I am moving it into left hand side. So it P lambda ds is going to stay. So that P lambda ds integration I need to do to get the lambda ds, to get the lambda ds. In the same manner, VQS circuit also same thing. VQS minus RSIQS, okay, minus omega R lambda ds, it is going to give the value of lambda QS. After getting lambda ds, lambda qs, you need to have the torque equation, right? So you need to frame the torque equation. So what is the torque equation? 3 by 2 P by 2, IQS, it is, 3 by 2 P by 2, IQS lambda ds minus IDS lambda QS. IQS lambda DS minus IDS lambda QS. So this is given to 3 by 2 P by 2. That is 3 into P by 4. So this is the torque equation. Torque equation. So this is the electromagnetic torque generated. So you know low torque equation. It is already known for you, low torque equation. What is that? Motor torque equal to load torque plus jt omega by dt. So the friction I am neglecting. So this is the electromagnetic torque, generated electromagnetic torque, and this is the load torque. I have taken outside. So this one is the load torque. This one is the load torque. So motor torque minus load torque is going to give jt omega by dt. So I require omega. So that is the reason I have done 1 by j. So d omega by dt integration I'll get as a omega. So this is mechanical. Here whatever the speed you are going to get, it will be in mechanical. So you need to convert into electrical. So that is the reason I have done P by 2. So omega electrical equal to P by 2 times of omega mechanical. So this is the actual speed which is given to the error block. This one, there it is. This one. So this is the actual speed of the PMSM. So in this manner, PMSM, with the help of PMSM modeling, we are doing the DTC operation. So this is the actual speed. From this actual speed, we are going to give that value to the error detector. So, and the process is like loop only. So whatever the generated lambda ds and lambda qs, so this from this generated lambda ds and lambda qs, I need to get magnitude right for comparison for the flux control loop. So I use the rectangular to polar conversion to get magnitude and also angle, flux space vector angle. So it follows the loop. So this is about the modeling of the PMSM and its operation with the help of direct torque control. So I'll run the simulation. So I am going to show you speed and flux. So this one flux and the torque information and the current, phase current. So the torque, my low torque I given as a 12.5, I guess. Yeah. So these are the results with the speed of rated speed 315 radian per second. You can see here. So the speed is reaching exactly to the 315, near to 315, and the flux, the actual flux of the machine is set to the reference flux, that is a 0.7, and the torque of the PMSM is near to the reference torque, that is 12.5. So that is my load torque. So load torque equal to motor torque, definitely. So it is near to the 12.5. If I do the average, so it will be near to the 12.5, and this is the phase current of the PMS. So these are the results for the DTC operated PMSM drive. You can perform the step changes in speed also. Suppose if I want to have my if I want to check my dynamic performance, such as when motor is rotating at 315 or 315 radian per second, so I want to provide my speed change in negative direction, that is minus 315 radian per second. So you can see the result. Yeah, you can see here the speed. I made command to change the speed from 315 to minus 315 at 2 seconds. So you can able to see here. So it is tracking and setting at minus 315. Yeah, you can ask one question, sir. Where I can see the regenerative mode? Where I can have the regenerative mode? So regenerative mode is possible. So you can see here. You can observe this region where speed is positive till zero. Till zero speed is positive, and what is torque? It is negative. So if you do power equal to omega into t, so the power is said to be negative. So generally, if you analyze the result in experimentally, so at this point of time, at 2 seconds, you may see that your capacitor is boosting up. The voltage of the capacitor is boosting up. So that means it indicates that the PMSM is supplying to the capacitor. So this is the regenerative mode of the drive. So from 2 to near to the 2.3, you can have the regenerative operation for the drive. So yeah, this is about my lecture. modeling of PMSM and its application in EV. So participants, anyone having doubts? And these are the parameters I considered for the machine. So if you are having any doubts, you please ask me.
Participants, if you have any doubts, please ask. Maybe, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, actually, I have a small doubt. When you show that MATLAB, no?
Yeah.
You have, in between, I had one small appointment. That's what I went out. And that sectors, how you are switching, can you show that? How you are doing the sector switching?
This one, sir.
So total six sectors, na, including null seven sectors. Seven points. Sectors are six, correct?
Yes, sir. Sectors are six.
So how you have given that switching? That's what I want to see.
Okay, sir. I'll show the table.
Okay.
So in sector one, if my torque is HT plus one, HZ plus one. So I selected V2, voltage vector. Okay. Else if my flux is plus 1 and torque is 0, V8 I am selecting. So V8 is a null vector.
Null vector.
Okay. And also if my HZ is plus 1, HT minus 1. HZ plus 1, HT minus 1, V6 I need to select.
V6
I need to select. So like that I made for sector 1. Similarly, it is for sector 2.
Okay.
For the sector 2. So in this manner, we need to make it.
Okay, sir, fine.
What is this? Yeah, participants, if you have any doubts, you please ask. Feel free to ask. No issue.
Excuse me, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, I am Priyanka Kulkarni. I wanted to ask one question. Sir, you said that in case of a DC motor control, constant flux control, and you can control the torque by controlling the current, armature current. But for this, see, we will need a current source, isn't it?
Yeah. If you apply voltage, it will have the impact on the current, right?
But if you want higher torque, then we will have to apply a higher voltage. It means.
Yeah.
Means so basically, it will be then the voltage control. You mean? How much voltage control?
By voltage control only we are doing the current. Okay. Current.
Yes. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Here, participants, please use the chance and ask some doubts and clarify your, if you have any doubts and your ideas also.
Sir, as time is there, I want to provide from research point of view what are the problems present in the drive application. So where the participants can do research. Let me tell in drive application what is the main research. So the research from the inverter side, generating the novel inverter structure, so with the less switches, having less THD, so and much more and higher efficiency. So this is the research from the inverter side. And coming to the control side, the research present in the steady state performance improvement. So actually I presented DTC, right? So if you see the ripple content in the torque, I'll just open the simulation. You see the ripple content in the torque. See the ripple content in the torque. It is around my reference is 12.5. You can see the upper and lower boundaries of the torque. It is touching at 14 and at bottom near to the 11. Near to the 11. So you may get doubt. You may get doubt. One doubt you may get. My band is within 1 to minus 1. You can see here. My torque ripple band, what I kept, it is within 1 to minus 1. So, how I am getting this much ripple content? See, so 12.5 means ideally how much it should be upper band? So, it should be 13.5. Am I correct? So, 12.5 plus 1. It should be 13.5. So how I am getting 14, near to 14 means my torque response is crossing above 14 also. You can see, you can observe here. Okay, so there is one research to improve the steady state performance, that is reducing the ripple reduction. So, what is the reason? I will tell you. Whatever the controller we are using nowadays, it is provided in the digital platform. So, we are doing in digital platform, right? We are doing in digital platform. So, what is going to happen means, your torque error is crossing the boundaries and your controller is not responding. Why? The reason is that, in digital control system, so it will look, it is a sample based control. It is a sample based control. Okay, so assume that at this point I started, so here only you reached your next sample. So in each sample, at starting only it will provide the control action, and for remaining time it won't provide any control action. So after reaching the next sample instant, then only control action is going to be takes place. So now the control action is takes place to reduce the ripple. Generally it follows the reference, right? So whatever the hysteresis band you provide, so it has to follow the whatever the response is generated, it has to follow the reference. It has to follow the reference. So here if you see this case, it is crossing the upper boundaries. In the same manner, it may cross the lower boundaries. The reason, main reason is that the digital control system is sample based. The digital control system is sample based. If you take analog control system, okay, it is not sample based. So whenever it touches the, whenever that error touches the boundary condition, so at that instant itself, it takes the control action. However, nowadays no one is looking for the analog control, so all are going towards the digital control. You know that for reliability purpose, okay, we are going for the digital control. So, however, digital control having the problem for the proper execution of this hysteresis controller. For proper execution of this hysteresis controller, there is a problem with the digital implementation. In digital implementation, this hysteresis controller can't respond as it is designed. So that is the main problem. So why the ripple is crossing above the boundary condition? So there is a research to improve the steady state performance by reducing the ripple. So when you reduce the ripple, okay, you will get better smooth performance. Smoother performance of the drive is established. So that is one of the important motive for the EV application. Okay, so your drive should exhibit smooth performance for EV. Okay, so this is the research going on in case of drives. Coming to the second point, common mode voltage. So this common mode voltage existence creates common mode current. So actually this current is going to flow through the bearings of the machine, so it is going to damage the machine for long time, means in long run. So your machine performance is going to degrade with the presence of this common mode voltage. Okay, so the second research is on reduction of the CMV and thereby common mode current. And the third one is control complexity. So how to reduce the control complexity? So this is the third research in case of electric drive. If you can reduce the control complexity, so with the simple processors itself, you can execute your algorithm, and with less cost, you can generate a product. So this is the third research going on in case of drive, control complexity. And replacing PI controller with the sophisticated controllers which are arrived now, like fractional PI controller. I guess you heard about fractional PI controller. So whatever the PI controller you are using in DTC, it is just a simple PI controller. So some papers claiming that with the introduction of fractional PI controllers, there is a much more improvement in the dynamic performance. So you can look into that one. And what are they? Complexity wise, improving the steady state performance, common mode voltage reduction, and further improvement in the dynamic performance. So these are the some of the important research areas in case of control point of view in electric drive. So from inverter point of view also, we can see there are introduction of multi-level inverters. You know why we are going for multi-level inverters? So to reduce the switch stress, and also for high power application. So there is a there are lot of multi-level inverter combinations. So you need to select suitable inverter which are well applicable for the EV system. So you need to design inverter in such a way that it should be applicable for the EV in various aspects, such as hybrid application. In hybrid application also, your inverter should operate. So there are certain inverter configurations which can support the hybrid type of supply. You can look into this research area also. With this I'm going to complete my session. Thank you everyone for your patient listening. If you're having any doubts, you can ask.
Any participants, if you have any doubts, please ask. Dr. Ravi sir, actually he is young and energetic. From this I came to know that in this young age how much work he is doing in this related to research, it is appreciable. And also the way of planning and presentation, also really happy to see that. I can also learn many things related to that vector control and director control of that Thurman Magnet synchronous motor. And also thank you so much sir being with us last this much time, and you have given a wonderful presentation, even including MATLAB simulation also. It will be very much beneficial the people who are doing that research in electrical vehicle, also some of the renewable energy system, and what are the topics you have already given, for some of the clues you have given for what are the gaps in research in this inverter side, multi-level inverter. Also I am really so much happy about your contribution of research, and I hope in future also I can see many activities from your side, and we can have a tie-up with this in forthcoming days also. As once again, I, behalf of all participants, I thank you, one and all, thanks to you for being with us today and giving a nice presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Okay, dear participants, next session will start at 2 o'clock. 2 o'clock. Then at 12 o'clock sharp, we will distribute that question through your WhatsApp group. So kindly complete it and finish the task before 2 o'clock. And please, I humbly request you, all of you, please attend validity function, and it is very much important. I have to record it and send to that IST members. So you will get initially now next week. We will give that next, not next week, maybe within 2 days, we will give a provisional certificate of participation, and IST members with IST will provide you that with the IST logo, the participation shortly after verifying the documents, what are all the things we are submitting. Thank you so much.